Hi, my name is Panagiotis Lontas, and I'm a graduate student at the Program for Logic and Computation and Algorithms. And I'm going to talk to you about cryptography and voting today, how the main ideas we borrow from cryptography to assist us in voting, and one particular aspect of these ideas, how to anonymize the votes. Okay. Let's begin. I will talk in general about about some of the requirements that you might need in a voting system. Some of these you might have heard before. Okay, but I'm going to recap a little bit in order to make a connection. Okay, what we need from a voting system? We need, first of all, we need integrity, which means that the votes must be recorded from the system as the voter intended, and must be counted by the system as they were recorded. This means that that the system cannot do anything with the votes, just recording. Okay. Of course, we also require ballot secrecy. So the voter must not we must not learn the vote of this voter, even if the voter wants us to. Some voters might want to sell their votes. Some people might want to coerce the voters into revealing their votes. We do not want this. Okay. Authentication and authorization. We must make sure that each voter votes one time, and that each voter votes exactly the way the election law mandates. Okay. The next property is very important. It's a soft property. It's called enfranchisement. What we need here is that the voters should be encouraged to vote. This is very important because if a voter does not trust the voting system, he will have doubts as to whether his votes will be counted, so he might be discouraged to vote. Okay, this is a very important property that is soft and it is not mentioned very often. Of course, the voting system will have to be available, both in the voting phase as well as in the tallying phase, when you count the votes and compute the result. And of course, the voting system must be efficient. Okay, in cost, in both cost and in time. As you have probably seen, these properties are conflicting. For example, authentication is in direct conflict with secrecy. From the moment we record the identity of this voter and verify it in order for him or her to vote, we have a possible problem with secrecy. Okay, because its vote corresponds in some way to a person. This link must not be revealed. And of course, enfranchisement, because in order to do the authentication and the authorization, each voter must have some sort of credentials. And some people might not be eligible, or might not be able to issue these credentials. Okay, so the main problem is that these properties are conflicting with each other. Okay, how do we interpret these votes in order to build the voting system? In order to have ballot secrecy, we require voter privacy. Okay, we require individual verifiability, which means this is essential for integrity. Individual verifiability means that each voter must be able to check that their ballot was correctly counted or included in the outcome. Okay, each voter, its own ballot. And of course, we would require a universal verifiability, which means that all voters should be able to check that the process went okay. This is very important in order to convince the loser. Okay, the loser should be convinced that he or she lost fairly. Okay, we require receipt freeness. The system cannot provide any sort of receipt to the voter, because such a receipt might be used in order to sell the vote or be coerced to vote in a particular way. We require robustness, okay? Nobody is able to disrupt the election. And we require fairness. Fairness means that no intermediate results should be known, because if any results are known, this gives incentive to somebody to change the votes, okay, or to cancel some votes, in order to have his desired outcome. Okay, These properties are also conflicting. Okay. For example, in order to cover individual verifiability, the system might issue a receipt to the voter, which contradicts its receipt fairness. Okay. Now, how can e-voting help to have better elections? Okay. The first thing that we must note here is that the way we vote currently is an election. It's a technology. It's a non-technology. It might be a non-technology, but it still is a technology. Okay, it might not be digital, but it is a technology. And if we look at it objectively, so many of the characteristics we described before are not there. For example, we do not have individual verifiability. We cast our votes, we go away, and we hope that the votes are included in the outcome. Okay. We also do not have universal verifiability, since we do not have individual verifiability. But we trust the system because we have grown to trust it. Our parents used to vote this way. Okay, everybody we know votes this way. Nobody has been charged after voting because he or she voted in a particular way. And we have grown to trust it. Okay. But if we, since we are computerizing the elections, many opportunities open up. Of course, the silliest one, I would say, is that we can count the votes faster. This is very important in countries that have a lot of population. Okay. We can select a winner by a variety of ways, not by just counting. But it's an opportunity to design the system from the ground up in order to implement some of these properties I mentioned before. Since we are going to do it with computers, a question remains if we can build systems that are so conflicting. Okay, and since we are going to do it with computers, we have a problem of lack of transparency. Because when you vote through a computer, you are not actually voting yourself, somebody else is voting for you. Okay, the computer is voting for you. It's like voting with a proxy. So, it's like having someone, another person, record your vote, and he is going to cast it, or she is going to cast it. He might be stupid and might not hear your vote correctly. Okay, he might be malicious and might try to change your vote. So, transparency is lacking. Okay, there is a very interesting documentary. If you can watch it. It's called Hacking Democracy, and it's about these problems: how lack of transparency can affect the elections. Okay. So, what can we do about it? One solution is to have all voting software be open source. Open source software can be scrutinized by everybody, by the voters themselves, by all parties, by everybody. And the accounting programs that the calculators all can be built by the voters, and they can do it themselves, probably. Okay, but we cannot be sure of the actual bits, even if the code is open, we have open source software. Even if the code is open, we will not be able to be exactly sure of the actual bit that do the counting. So something stronger is needed. Of course, open source software will play a role in the future of voting. But I think the best solution for this is cryptography. Cryptography is an ancient art, and it has been in the last 30 years it has been turned into a science that that can be used to keep secrets. Okay, but also it can be used to build trust. How can this happen? By keeping the secrecy and verifying everything. Every action can be turned into a mathematical problem with cryptography, and the users can calculate the solutions themselves. So they build the trust by verifying each operation. So I'm going to talk to you about how cryptography affects the voting, the ideas from cryptography that affect the voting procedure and the counting. Okay, I don't know how many of you have had classes about cryptography. Okay, some of you. Okay, I will do a brief overview to get the ideas, and then I will move on to the main subject. Okay, one of the most important cryptographical tools are hash functions. Hash functions are functions that take arbitrary size data and compact it to fixed size data. Okay, but with some important properties. If we have the message, the arbitrary size data, it's very easy to calculate the hash. But we cannot go backwards. Given the hash, it must be computationally infeasible to calculate the message. Given the hash, it must be computationally infeasible to find another message such that the two hashes collide. And for any two given messages, for any random messages, we cannot find two random messages that have the same hashes. Okay. The other very important cryptographical tool are public key cryptosystems. Okay. Public key cryptosystems, if you have heard, have solved the millennial problem, how to communicate securely with somebody that you have never met. And it happened in 1976. Okay. So, how do they do this? Each user has a public and a private key. Okay, in order to send an encrypted message, we retrieve the user's public key, we encrypt our message with it, and we send it. And when the user receives it, it is encrypted with his private key. These systems can be turned around in order to provide signatures by encrypting with a private key. And its security is based on consensus hard problems from number theory, such as factoring, calculating the discrete logarithm and quadratic reciprocity. Okay, the most important system, the first system for public key cryptography was RSA in 1977. Okay, I won't go into much detail here because we will not meet later, but you must check that encryption is an exponentiation. And the decryption is an exponentiation as well. Okay, and the powers are selected in such a way that they cancel out, and we receive we get the message. Okay, now RSA security is based on the difficulty of factoring. If we can factor numbers, then we can break RSA. Okay, and but there might be some other ways. This is another problem. A very important cryptographic tool that I would like to stress out here is threshold encryption. Threshold encryption is a way that you can split the private key so that no single user can decrypt the message. Some users must come together in order to use each of them has a part of the private key. Okay, some of them might come together and build the secret key and decrypt the message. It's a very important tool because it enables the distribution of trust to many people. Okay. A very important also cryptographic primitive is cryptographic concept is homomorphic encryption. You might have heard of this during the English presentation. Homomorphic encryption allows us to do computation with encrypted data. Okay. So we apply a function to the ciphertext. That corresponds to another function, to the plaintexts. Okay, and then we can decrypt the result of this application on the ciphertext and retrieve the function on the plaintext. Okay, using the key, the private key. If we could apply this to the elections, we would require that we have such a function that corresponds to adding the plaintexts. And if we have the ciphertext of the sum of the plaintext, then we can do a simple decryption and retrieve the result. Okay. But this might not be the only way. The winner might not be selected by simple adding. There might be other ways to select the winner. And we would require the homomorphic encryption to support all this. Okay, but this is in theory possible. In practice, it's not yet implemented. It would be very interesting if somebody could do homomorphic encryption on arbitrary functions. Okay, in theory, it has been said that we can do it. Okay. So, the main crypto system that is going to be used in election is the Agamal crypto system that was invented in 1984. It's based on security. It's based on the hardness of the discrete logarithm function. Okay, I will write it on the board in order to have it for future slides. Okay, so during encryption we get a message. It's a randomized encryption, and which means randomized encryption means that each ciphertext of the same message will be different somehow. And the randomization is built into the encryption system. In the RSA, randomization was not built into the system. We had to provide it ourselves as an add-on. In this crypto system, randomization is built inside the system. So, what happens? We generate two large primes. Okay, we generate this form, we generate a generator of a group. We select the generator of a group, okay? And we input this into the system, and we generate a random number, okay? So, during encryption, a random number is generated, and the two components are calculated. The one is this, we can call this G, okay? And the other one is the message multiplied by the public key raised to the randomization factor. Okay, we can call this M. So the output of the encryption is a tuple. It's two pairs, one pair. Okay. Now, during decryption, we can take, how does is decryption made? Decryption is made by, so see, Y is this hit, is this next during the generation phase. Okay, so during decryption, decryption is a very simple process. We perform a division and an exponentiation. Okay, and if we do the math, the message is retrieved. Okay, we will keep this. You can see it for future reference. Okay, and its security is based on the difficulty of the computing with script logarithm. Okay, now, what is important for the El-Gamal crypto system? It is that it has two very important properties. The first one is called re-encryption. We can change the ciphertext without knowing the private key. Just with the ciphertext, we can change it. How does this happen? It happens by a single multiplication of the ciphertext with the encryption of the message one. If we have a ciphertext, it's of this form, okay? The encryption of the message one is this. So, this is so if we do a pairwise multiplication, we get a valid El-Gamal ciphertext. Another ciphertext. Okay. We cannot tell if two messages are the one in encryption of the other without knowing the arc prime or the secret key. Okay. Another very important property of El-Gamal is that it is multiplicatively homomorphic, which means that the product of two encryptions is equal to the encryption of the product of two messages. This is very important as well, because it has I will write this down in order to... If we raise the encryption of the message to a power, it's equivalent to encrypting the power of the message. Okay. In the election system, we require additive homomorphism, as we said earlier. There is a solution in this El-Gamal. Instead of multiplying with the message, we can raise the message, the generator to the message, having a goal within a number, and we can apply, we can have an additive homomorphism, but in order to decrypt, we would require to solve the discrete logarithm problem, which is hard. So this is not widely used, But in theory, it is supported. In order to have pure additive homomorphism, other crypto systems might be required. Now, another very important cryptographic tool are commitment schemes. In order to understand commitment schemes, we can use an example. If we flip a coin and we are both present during the flipping, we can both verify that the result is correct. Okay, but if we do it over the telephone, we are not both present. The one party can select heads or tails, and the other party on the other line cannot, that flips the coin, does not have to flip the coin. He can just announce the result that he likes in order to win. And the other party, the first party, cannot verify anything. Okay, so we need to be able to do a coin flipping over the telephone. How is that? Cryptography provides us a way for the one party to commit to one heads or tails. This commitment is a special kind of action that has two properties, the blinding property, the commitment is not revealed, okay? And the binding property, the party that has committed to a value cannot change the value. Okay, so the first party, Alice, will commit to something. She will send a commitment to the other party, to Bob. Okay, Bob will not find anything about the value that Alice has selected, but Alice will not be able to change that value. He will flip the coin, he will announce the result. Okay, so Alice will reveal the commitment then, after the fact. Okay, and both can check the result. Okay, cryptography here provides us with some functions to do this, to be able to do this. Another very important cryptographic tool are zero-knowledge proof, which were introduced in 1985 by these three people called Vassar, Satya Goldwasser, Silvio Micali, and Charles Rankoff, I think. I don't know if you have heard about yesterday. Satya Goldwasser and Silvio Micali won the Turing Award for parts of this work as well. Okay. So what is a zero-knowledge proof? It's an interactive protocol between two parties. The one party is called prover. The prover wants to convince the other party, the verifier, that he knows something without revealing anything about it. And they have proposed a protocol to do this. Okay, this protocol must have three essential properties. Completeness, which means that if both the prover and the verifier are honest, the protocol works and the verifier is convinced. Okay. Soundness, which means that if the prover is dishonest, then he cannot convince the verifier. And zero knowledge is that the verifier does not learn anything from the protocol. Okay, an example in order to understand this better is this one. Imagine that we have two people, the prover and the verifier, and the verifier is colorblind, cannot see the colors, okay, any color. And the prover holds two identical boxes that have different color. The prover wants to convince the verifier that the boxes indeed have different color, okay. Without the verifier knowing the color, the verifier cannot know the color anyway because he is colorblind. Okay, how can this be done in zero knowledge? The prover will give the verifier boxes. Okay, the verifier will hide the boxes behind his or her back, and he might choose to switch them or not. And after the switch, okay, he might have switched them, he might not have switched them. After the switch, he will prevent the box to the verifier, to the prover. The prover, of course, can see the colors and can immediately see if they have been switched or not. Okay, so the verifier might be convinced, but of course the verifier might also think that the prover was lucky and he guessed it. Okay, so he will repeat the experiment sometimes, and after the repetition, okay, he will be convinced that the boxes are made of different color. Now, how does these protocols work in real cryptography? One application of such protocol is the SNORR protocol. It's a zero-knowledge protocol in order to prove that you know the discrete logarithm of something. How is this operated? The prover wants to convince the verifier that he knows x such that So, he sends a talent, he sends a message. The verifier receives the message where t is a random number. Okay, the verifier receives the message, generates another value, a random value. Okay, the prover responds, the prover knows t, receives c, and knows x. So the prover responds with this value. Okay. See that the verifier does not learn anything about x, but checks if this equation holds. And if this equation holds, then he can be convinced that the prover knows the x, okay, the speed logarithm. This scheme has been used for authentication. You can prove that you know the password without revealing the password. Okay. And the variation of this is known, is used in the electronic system. It's the Chan-Peterson protocol, which enables the prover to convince the verifier that two logarithms are equal. Okay, it's a variation of the Snore protocol. A very important thing about the zero-knowledge protocols, about some types of zero-knowledge protocol, is that the verifier is not needed. The challenge here by the verifier can be replaced with a hash function of the messages the prover generates. So the prover can prove himself, and he can release the transcript of the proof for anybody to verify later. This is by due to Fiat and Samir. Okay, now we move on to the main issue of our presentation, mixnets. Okay, mixnets solve the anonymity problem in e-voting. Okay, it's a solution to voter privacy. Mixnets were introduced in 1981 by David Chalmers. And it's not only used, they are not only used for e-voting, but in general when we require anonymity. Okay, the original paper, they have many uses, and the original paper by Chan has 3,500 citations. Okay, let's look at a drawing in order to see how mixnets work. Okay, we have the votes, or the messages in general. Okay, voter or its message sender encrypts the votes through a function and enters them to the mixnet. The mixnet is a series of mixed servers, of entries that are called mixed servers. What do these mixed servers do? They receive the encryption of the votes and change them somehow, change the encryption, okay, and select the random permutation of the input and output the random permutation. The first mixnet does this operation, then gives the outputs to the second mix server, okay, does the same. This process goes on. Okay. The all communication is done through a bulletin board. The drawing here might not be accurate. The mix server 1 does not send the votes to the permutation of the votes to the second mix server. The votes are added to the bulletin board, and the second mix server reads them from there. Okay, and in the end, the votes are decrypted through another phase. This might not be required, it might be obligatory, it might be optional. Okay, and we have the votes in a random order. The link to the input has been lost. Okay, so then we can do the tallying, or we can compute the winner of the election, and whatever we would like. Okay. Okay, this is the process. Okay, now we have two types of mixnets. The first type of mixnet is called decryption mixnets, which is the original idea by Chan. Decryption mixnets change the vote by decrypting. The voter has encrypted the ballot using the public key of all the mixed servers that are going to be used in the system, in reverse order. So, the first mixed server receives the input, peels off by using his secret key the first layer of encryption, okay, and applies the permutation, the random permutation. By decrypting, the mix server, the first mix server, has changed somehow its vote. Okay, it's essential to change the votes, because if you have the mix server here, and one input matches, one output matches one input, then you can create a link, and you can see that this type of permutation was applied. Okay, so all outputs must be different from all inputs. And by decryption, we get that. This proposal by Chang is very important, because it's independent of the underlying crypto system. But it has some drawbacks. The drawbacks are that the cipher takes disproportional to the number of the mix server, because each mix server applies his own randomness. Okay. And of course, another important disadvantage is that each mix server can block the process by refusing to decrypt. And this is particularly true for the last mix server, because as the last mix server, we must know that it has the full access to the values themselves, because he decrypts for the last time. Okay. So he's more powerful than the other ones in some way. Another variation of mixnets is due to Park, Ito, and Kurosawa in 1993, and has two versions. It does not use decryption. It uses the process of re-encryption we said earlier. It changes the votes, the ciphertext of the votes. Okay. So after each mix server changes, we must decrypt in the end. We must have an extra decryption phase. And of course, in order not to have a mix server that is powerful again, we can use the threshold decryption scheme we mentioned earlier, and distribute the private key to the decryption key to many parties. Okay, and then a variation of this is that not only do we use re-encryption, but we use decryption as well. We peel off and we re-encrypt. Okay, these are very widely used in voting. But there is an attack here. There is a very important attack. There are many important attacks. One is this one, and it uses the fact that L-gamal is multiplicatively homomorphic. So, how can we trace a message to the mixnet? If we want to trace this message, okay, we retrieve the ciphertext. This has been entered to the mixnet in a cipher form, and we raise the ciphertext to a power. Okay. In order to do this, we must have access to the bulletin board, or if we cannot do this, we must let's say bribe a voter and have his message be here. Okay. Have him input this message. In the output, we will have, after all the mixing, we will have both M and M to the power. So, what can we do? We can raise all messages to the power and check for duplicates. The duplicate message, okay, will be revealed. The message that's duplicate will be revealed. Okay. Of course, there are many variations of this attack. We might break the privacy with some more processing. We might break the privacy of many voters. But okay, what's the problem? Why is this attack able to work? Because mixers have these problems. Okay, at the initial encryption stage, a different vote might be encrypted. For example, we will not vote ourselves, but we will vote in a way that cancels the vote of another person. This is called vote canceling. Okay, we will not vote freely, we will vote in a way that we copy the vote to another person. So we might not have the vote, but we might vote with the encryption of another person. Of course, the mix servers themselves cannot be trusted. Okay, each mix server can take some of the input values and drop them off and introduce some of his own values. Okay, and of course some mix servers might cooperate to break anonymity. Okay, by tracing some messages. So what can we do about them? We can do many things, but the solution must be efficient, correct, and privacy respecting. By changing these properties, we have many mixed protocols. And we will see some of them now. all these protocols, of course, have one thing in common. We prove in zero knowledge the contents of the vault. We apply the zero knowledge systems before, that we mentioned before, to prove the contents of the vault. And each mixed server proves the correctness of the surface. That he did correct the surface, he did not introduce his own vaults. Okay. So, how do we prove that the initial encryption is correct? We must prove that we know the discrete logarithm. Okay, and how do we prove the correctness of the sampling? We must prove that each encrypted vault in the input appears in the output in a valid encryption form. And many papers have been written in order to address this situation. Okay, the first one is the first universally verifiable mixnet is due to Gillian and Sacco in 1995. Okay. It does not use exactly zero knowledge, but use a variation of it called the cut and choose protocol. So, what does this mix protocol do? It performs a secondary encryption and a secondary sampling, and the prover is the mix server. Okay, and the verifier asks either the secondary encryption or the difference of the secondary encryption with the primary encryption. The same applies for sampling as well. Okay, and the mix server does a secondary permutation with newer randomization values. The mix the verifier requests either the secondary sample or the difference between the primary sample and the secondary sample. I think this approach was used in previous versions of Helios or of the Helios voting system. Another approach to building verifiable mixnets is due to permutation networks. We can implement each mix server with using a permutation network or a sorting network in particular. Okay, in a sorting network, we perform the re-encryption of the ciphertext. Okay, and we must and we also perform the sampling, and we must prove that the second output. Okay, this is a 2x2 sorting network. The second output is a re-encryption of either the first input or the second input, and the same one for the first output. So we can build each mix server by generalizing this structure, repeating it, and creating an n times n sorting network. We will see that they are not efficient. So some approaches have been taken to create efficient mixed network. The two most famous approaches in this is the Furukawa and Sacco mixing, where mixing is represented as a matrix multiplication. And in order for the mixing to occur, for a permutation to occur, the prover must prove that there exists a matrix that's called a permutation matrix. Okay, you can see an example here of a permutation matrix, and that the prover must convince the verifier that for the input and the output there exists a particular matrix like this, and that it has been used in order to generate the output. We will see that this is quite fast, and another fast mixnet is the NEF mixnet, okay, which represents the inputs and outputs as polynomials, and uses the fact that polynomials the value of the polynomials are affected by the permutation of the roots. Okay, so the verifier chooses a random point, constructs polynomials from the input and the output, and evaluates them at the random point. And the results, in order for the mixnet to be verifiable, the result must match with very high probability. Okay, now let's see about the performance of the verifiable mixnets. Okay, the cost of what we measure in the performance is the cost of the initial encryption, the cost of the sampling and the proof of the correct sampling, and the cost of the decryption. Okay, the cost of the encryption and the decryption is the same for everybody. So let's see what the cost of the proof of the encryption and sampling is. The first mixnet you see for n servers and for n voters and k servers is this. Okay, the sorting network cost is this. You see that the Furukawa and Sacco mixing and the NEF mixing are very cheap. Okay. But still, in the NEF mixing, which is the fastest, as you can see here, in order to verify 1 million votes, you need 20 hours. Okay. So, okay, these numbers are a little long, but you get the idea. Why is this? Because zero knowledge proofs are computationally expensive. So there has been there have been other approaches, okay, that sacrifice some privacy and or some correctness in order to achieve a faster mixing and a faster proof of mixing. The most widely used approach is this one in 2001, that was issued in 2001 by Jackson, Jewels and Rivest, which is called the randomized partial checking. And the idea is very simple. You can give up, you have to give up the expensive notion of the proof and do a probabilistic verification. Okay, how does this happen? The verifier asks from its mix server to reveal a subset of the input-output correspondence. Okay, you will see here that in order to verify the mix, we sacrifice privacy from its mix server. We reveal the votes. Okay, we reveal how the votes have been encrypted and how the votes have been permuted. Of course, before the revelation, its mix server must commit to the permutation in order not to change it later. Okay, so what can we do about privacy? In order to see this, we pair its servers. In order not to lose privacy, we pair all mixed servers. Okay, so and the verifier asks the revelation in such a way that no complete path from the end, from the start to the end, is revealed. For example, you can see here that only the bold lines are revealed. So, for example, the first vote in the first mixed server is revealed that the first input goes to the first output, okay? But then we lose the link, we do not reveal for the second server where the second vote went. So we cannot trace a vote from the end to the beginning. Okay, so each mixed server does not have the property of privacy, okay? But the mixset as a whole has this property. And this is widely used. It is very fast, okay? Because no zero knowledge proof is required. You reveal the encryptions, okay, you reveal the input and the output, and you can validate yourself. Another approach is we do not sacrifice the privacy, we sacrifice the correctness. So what does this mean? The idea is that if the margin of victory in an election is wide, okay, we might not need 100% correct proof of the mixing. We might need a smaller percent that will not affect the margin of victory, the winner or the loser. Okay, so how do we do this? We select a random subset of the mix server inputs, the verifier. Okay, we calculate the product, we reveal the product to the mix server. Okay, and we require him to produce a set of outputs such that the product is maintained. The honest mix server can do this very easily. Okay, simply apply the permutation and calculate the result. Okay, the cheating mix server might be impossible to find such a subset. So he might be able to convince us, he might be able not to convince us. Okay, he might be exposed, he might not be exposed. But the problem with this protocol is that that cheating is discovered after the fact. Okay, so another variation is used. Okay, so we do calculate the product here, okay, as before, and product preservation, and because product preservation might not imply absence of cheating, we encrypt the user input twice. Okay, we encrypt the user input in LGAMAL, but we generate a hash of the encryption, and we encrypt the hash as well. So we have a double layer of encryption here. What this means is that the mix servers operate on two encryptions. So if cheating happens, the cheating will not expose the privacy of any vote because of the double layer encryption. Okay, and if we discover that the cheating has happened, we can give this the votes to a verifiable mixnet, to a completely verifiable mixnet like before. Okay, and have them produce the output. Okay. The thing is here, how do we perform the validation and how do we identify the cheaters? So, all the encryptions are forwarded to the mix net. Okay. So, the mix net does the mixing, the permutation and the encryption. And when the end comes and we have the results, okay, we decrypt once. We check that the products are the same. This can be checked because of the homomorphic property. And we check that the checksums are the same. Okay, if we have cheating, some checksums might not match. So we start from the back and we ask each mix server to reveal the input and the randomizer that he used. Okay, we check that. If we reach the first server, we can be sure that the mixnet was due to the voters, that the cheating was due to the voters, that the mix server operated correctly, so we can decrypt and announce the result without taking into account these voters. If a server is exposed as cheating, then we can use one of the verifiable mixnets that I mentioned earlier. Okay, this is all that I had to say. Okay, what can you take home with you? The internal voting can improve the voting process, okay, and in a way that we can have some properties that are not found in traditional election systems. Okay, but we have a problem of trust, and this problem of trust might discourage some people from going to vote, so a way to mitigate this problem is with cryptography. Okay, if we know that every operation can be verified mathematically, okay, we can build that trust. Okay, one way to do this, and one way to keep the anonymization of the votes that is essential to build this trust, is mixnets. Okay, that it's a fairly mature technology. It has been around for 30 years, and it has been extensively researched for 20 years. Okay, many protocols for mixnets have been used, okay, that provide different levels of privacy, correctness, or efficiency. Okay, the building blocks are there. Okay, the work that must be done is in their composition and their proof of security. Okay, but I think the goal that you should take home is the words of Ben Adida, the creator of Ilus. We must not trust anything, we must verify everything with cryptography. Okay, that's all I have to say. Thank you very much. Yes, in elections we require addition. To add that to votes.
Yeah. Why did you use a cryptographic technique that has that property?
Yes, that's a very interesting question, because the LKMAN protocol is very easy to produce the zero knowledge proofs.
Yes.
In other cryptographic systems, like the Bayesian system that is additively homomorphic, it's not very easy to have the zero knowledge proofs.